Hello.
Darcelle XV in Portland, Oregon. It's the oldest surviving drag club in the United States. It began in the 1960s as a tavern, primarily serving a lesbian crowd. These days, a night out at Darcelle XV is a uniquely Portland rite of passage for young brides-to-be. At bachelorette parties on the eve of their weddings, brides and their friends, many from conservative Christian communities, enjoy wild flings as they are ushered into the institution of matrimony by drag queens. After four decades of continuous performances, Darcelle, co-proprietor, performer, and activist, has become a legend in the Pacific Northwest. She guides thousands of people who come to the club each year as they celebrate or mourn important moments in life, from getting married or coming out, to recovering from divorce or illness. The club invites people to free themselves of repressive inhibitions, but it takes considerable skill to manage the intense emotions that often emerge. And that's an art that requires a deep understanding of human psychology.
So at times you're a group therapist.
Yes.
Yeah, I know, and I don't get a damn dime for it.
I have
extra.
Said for years and years and years, we should be granted complimentary or whatever it is, that some kind of a documentation that for us to be psychoanalysts.
When I'm interviewing a bachelorette or a birthday, and all of a sudden they tell me something that is way beyond what I should hear, I'm expecting. I have five children at home. I'm unwell. You know what I mean? And so all of a sudden, I have to level off and make them feel so comfortable that it'll be okay with them and with me. I'm really sharp when we first start, and all of a sudden I hear pain here. There's pain. So you level off and make sure that you leave them knowing that I hear it and I understand it and that I can empathize with it, that I know how you're feeling.
Some of the bachelorettes are coming in to be wild, but they never have been wild. So they're just, it's gonna like, let's go in and get wild. And the next thing you know, they have a couple of cocktails and they're blotto because they don't party at all. You know what I mean?
What color dress did you wear?
I wore white.
Of course you did. See this whole row of people?
White.
They all friggin' lie. It's okay.
Your name?
Danielle.
Huh?
Danielle.
When are you getting married, Danielle?
August 2nd.
Is that a church wedding?
Yes.
Where?
Church of the Good Shepherd in Vancouver.
Is that a Catholic church?
Episcopalian.
Oh, that's good. Church wedding?
Yes.
What church?
First Assembly of God. And
get in front of me, everybody, and kneel down. Now, wait a minute. Okay, we don't care. Now, tell me one thing. What color dress are you wearing at the church? White?
White.
What church, Elaine?
First Christian.
In Forest Grove?
Yes.
Okay. I probably won't be there. Now, my sweet, what color dress are you wearing?
White.
the balls to wear a white dress? Well, good luck, honey. We know you've been saving yourself for the Christian church, of course you have.
Some of them get a little bit put back when I say their bridesmaid dresses are ugly. See, I've seen all the bridesmaid dresses in the world, you know, I have.
And you're kind of poking fun a bit at the whole marriage trappings.
The trappings part of it, not the marriage part of it, the trappings part of it. Wearing a white dress, if they say they're wearing an amber dress, or not amber, but cream-colored dress, I said white would be a stretch, and they laugh, they love it. And the bridesmaid dresses are ugly, make pillows out of them afterwards, and all that sort of thing. It's part of making them have a good time and realizing that tomorrow is going to be the serious part of it. Tonight's not the serious part of it.
They have no idea. I was talking about, you know, when you come into our doors, we have our own laws and our own rules, and that's what they think. They really think that, and they think when they come into the door, it's like Alice in Wonderland. They can do whatever they want. Everything around them is theirs. This is their place, and they're just having a good time. You know, sometimes it gets frustrating because they've had a little too much to drink somewhere else and then come here, or they just are so excited. They're just so happy to see us, and they're just so happy to be free of the men in their lives, or happy to be free of working, and they're just here to have a good time.
But there's usually someone who just is fascinated by us, and if they've been drinking, they get a little more free, I guess, with their hands. And was it that number, or was it something else? I'm not sure if it was that number, if it was. I think it was that number, you're right. Just sort of got to the end of the stage, and then her hand just sort of started at my ankle and went all the way up my leg and then up my dress as I was kind of push her hand away. So, but she did find the top, and then I just sort of pushed her away and said thank you and walked to the other side of the stage. To me, boundaries are really important. I don't like people to touch me, you know, at all, unless they're invited. But
isn't that part of the tipping, though?
Not necessarily. If you kind of go like this, then that gives them the, okay, you could put it right here, or you could hit your hand out, that's another thing. But when they go like that lady and just sort of just feel her way, you know, it's not acceptable to me, and it's not comfortable to me. So I gracefully do what I can to accept the tip and get away from the person.
Does it ever feel that the audience crosses a line in touching you?
No, not at all. I'm a man in a dress. That's pretty much saying, here, touch me.
Whereas if I was a man, I don't think they would touch me.
So you never need your assistance
again. It was all in fun.
What if you were a woman?
And doing the same thing? Oh, no, that'd be different. The OLCC says no one can touch a woman in their private parts. But since I'm not a woman, they can touch my fake tits all they want to.
Your name?
Sarah! I so want to see it!
We already did that. Now we're going to talk to her.
When I meet these ladies, I often wonder, now what kind of a husband are you really marrying here?
Enjoying wearing on your own.
Personally think that the majority of our audiences here absolutely love Destiny. You know, they love Destiny as a woman, they love Destiny as a man, and I have to, in most of the production numbers, I'm next to Destiny, and so I always watch people look at her, and I'm like, I'm not even there. It's so funny to like, when I'm on stage by myself, it's different, but when I'm with Destiny at any number, I like watch the audience, and most of them are like looking at her like this, and smiling, you know, they're like,
she seduces them.
I know.
She looks them straight in the eye, and that tongue.
I know. I hear you. It's like the rest of us aren't even there while you're on stage because I love her, you know, and I like the fact that it makes me feel more comfortable because they're not. I mean, I'm like one of those odd performers, you know, I do this stuff for attention, but I don't want a lot of attention because I do what I do. You know, I want to just, you know, enough to get by and, you know, that's great, but I don't want, like, Destiny, all that sexual energy that's, like, shooting toward you,
you know? You also seem to really look, you have that kind of sexual stare, sexual come to me look, and with your tongue, let me see your tongue. I've been practicing at home. No,
I mean, that was for my straight days.
They just feel like they know you, so they, you know, want to touch you and feel you and, you know, do this because you're just a character in their mind. You're not a real person. You're just, you know, sort of like this thing, you know, that appears and disappears. And as that character, they feel that they feel they can pretty much do whatever they want to you or say whatever they want to say to you because you're not a real person.
I do sometimes feel guilty about that. I mean, I do. I feel like, oh my gosh, you know, this is what this person is, and I'm giggling about it, you know? And so sometimes I do have that, like, well, what does that mean? Is that even fair? You know, that I'm sitting here, but then I'm like, no, because entertainment is something totally different than just being giggly.
But you thought about it for a moment.
I totally did.
Like, who pays the price of the joke,
who
or what's told, being
exactly,
fun?
Exactly. What's funny and what is supposed to be, you know, what's serious.
Do you think gays have something to teach straight people about the group side of celebrating sexuality?
I think so, because I think when gay men and women are growing up, they're lonely. It's just there, they're lonely. Built in, mm-hmm. Built in. You're lonely sometimes with your family, of course, and sometimes in your school, you're lonely. So when you do get around people that you can be yourself with, then you get around a lot of people. Yeah. Always a lot. There's always big functions, a lot of fun things happening. It isn't just two people. That's why gay bars are so popular, because even if you're by yourself, once you get there, you're not by yourself anymore.
Johnny's gonna wear the white one.
My partner and I, Roxy, I mentioned to him, you know, when this all started some time ago, what do you think? Are we going to get married if we can get married? He said, well, we're together, both in spirit and physically and the whole thing. We're like joined at the hip. So I don't know where that would be for me, but you're not asking my opinion on whether I think I should get married. You're asking my opinion on whether I feel that the gay community is losing something. Yeah, we've always lost something. Let's get equal in other directions too. How about housing? How about jobs? How about if you come out at your job and you're fired because, for some other reason, but of course, but because they know you're queer. How about that? How about health care for everybody? How about our friends with AIDS, making sure that they get their medications, regardless of what their sexual orientation was.
You've got two more to go, so don't go away. Ooh. He does really well down on this.
There was a guy, first show, who, when I went down the aisle, he shook my hand, then he wanted to shake it again, and he was being rude. I mean, I could just see his eyes, and he shook my hand really hard. The big old muscle just went, which I thought was cute. But the point is, he did it for a reason, not because he wanted to shake my hand. He had to do this very, very hard to show that he was a man.
Yeah.
Yeah, get out of here.
Isn't it rich? Are we a pair? at last on the ground. You will end me there.
Where are
you? Got a little circle back there. You're gonna have to change your religion and wear a yarmulke. That'll work. I'm going to do that. I'm going to circumcise first, and then I'm going to. I have one too. So what? We're having fun. Who's this? Hi, Jerry. Good for you, Jerry. Yeah, you want? I would show you mine, but I'd have to take my wig off. Mine's bigger than yours. I mean, no, the hole in the back of the head.
I thought it was entertaining. I don't know if I would show up again, but you gotta do everything once.
You're sort of suggesting some people might have trouble with it.
Maybe, yeah, I would say maybe some people would.
What kinds of things might people struggle with?
The whole thing.
I thought it was hilarious, but I mean, it's definitely not something that you really want to get caught seeing.
Men are supposed to be manly and not feminine.
I mean, they kind of cross a boundary that men aren't supposed to cross. Mm-hmm.
Maybe that's what people think.
It questions their manlyhood a little bit tonight.
In what way?
By watching men that are dressed up in dresses.
What does this mean when you do that? You think you're proving something to you? I just want to show you that I did have fun. Yeah, well,
it's so funny because we were like, oh, that's our favorite. Oh, she's our favorite.
Even your man, even
who do you think you know definitely was so. Definitely a man? You're like, well, he's so funny.
Oh, and I know there's another thing that I experienced. Like, I was like, okay, if I was a gay man. Because we did this earlier today where we said, that these are our girls. We picked our own girls today. And as heterosexual women,
we picked
our girls that, like, okay, well,
if you were a woman lover.
If I was a lesbian, I would be with Gwen Stefani. Because she's hot.
Women seem to be more comfortable with it.
Oh, definitely.
Well, I mean, when you first get in there being a guy, you're like, oh, what the hell am I doing here? And then as the show goes on, you get a little bit more and more warmed up to it.
How do you think the show helped you kind of feel more at ease?
It's just funny. I mean, if it wasn't funny, you'd be sitting in there going, what the hell am I doing here? We need to leave.
Bobbitt. Not every ordinary dumbass Bobbitt jokes, but the book is out. Dedicated to lovely wife Lorena. Open the book. Dedicated to my lovely wife Lorena. No hard feelings. Lorena Bobbitt was in a horrible auto accident. Some dick cut her off. Just.
That's right.
Okay. Let's get something straight right at the beginning. I work alone, okay? I know you want to be a star, but...
You know, they come in and they think, here's a bunch of fairies, and they'll take whatever I've got to give them. Well, we don't take whatever they got to give us. This is my house, not their house. So we don't put up with their bullshit.
And he was testing that one.
He was testing. Of course he was. He was testing the waters.
To see what he could get away with.
And then he couldn't get away with very much, so he settled down.
There's my teeth.
Come on. Where is it?
There you are. Oh, we need a penis.
Who made those?
Darcelle did.
Darcelle did? Those are so
And I
great.
Was the model.
You were the model?
No, I'm kidding.
Those are so wonderful.
Oh, it's that one, huh?
Yeah. It's a miracle we spend 3 hours to hide it and then 2 minutes to put it on.
What does it take for a man to do that thing, do you think?
I would say balls too, which is so like, it seems so wrong. To say that they need big balls to be drag queens.
There's some that can fool you. There's a couple I can fool you. They look like women.
Uh-huh.
So...
Yeah. You mean there was just, like, kind of sexiness?
Yeah, I mean, they look like women. So if I didn't know otherwise, then I'd believe it. So...
Some of us can spot them a little better than others.
I'm a go-go girl at a straight bar.
Huh.
Which is kind of interesting.
And are you known as a female impersonator, or you go as a woman?
I go as a woman. It's weird, too, because when I got hired, one of the people only knew me as a woman. One of them had only known me as a guy. And the security guard had actually seen me as both before. He had been there for my good go-go job year, that I started probably 4 years ago. I had started at Cobalt Lounge as a go-go boy about 4 years ago, and then after working there for, the only one too, after working there for about 6 months, they fired me because they were like, well, it's straight guys that are paying the cover and paying for most of the drinks, so, you know, the novelty wore off and we don't need you anymore, so here's $20 for showing up and bye. And I would still hang out with the girls I used to dance with in face, which is the term we usually prefer for in drag. And I ended up being hired back about 8 months later as a go-go girl, and my boss had no idea, and I ended up being one of the two highest paid dancers there.
Part of my job as the choreographer in Las Vegas was to work with the real gorgeous statuesque women and the girls who'd carry these headdresses and stuff around and teach them how to walk and walk like showgirls and present themselves. There's a style and a way to move to be a showgirl. And I thought, well, I suppose you could teach a guy the same thing and teach them to do, you know, that technique is the same and the moves could be developed the same way as the showgirls in Las Vegas. The whole idea of drag, I think, is in general a little bit of poking fun of gender in general, not just females, but males also.
Almost all children dress up one way or the other, in preschool and in daycares and stuff, they always have a costume section or whatever, and boys are putting on girls' things, whatever, and it's just a fun dress-up thing, and it's not anything, you know, it's just playing. And so I think a lot of people either suppress that and forget about that they even had that, and maybe come in and they do kind of think back to, oh wow, I remember when I did that, you know, and it was fun.
My mom dressed me up as Dolly Parton in fourth grade.
So you've done a little.
So I actually went to school like that.
Well, didn't you camp it up too? Weren't you telling me that?
I camped it up. Yeah. They won this costume. And they didn't know whether I got the boys category or the girl category.
We used to do it to my brother all the time, put bows in his hair and all kinds of stuff like that. So it was great.
For Halloween once when I was at junior high, and he did when he was in high school.
It just depends on how they came through the door, you know, where they're coming from. You know, if it's just real macho, yeah, you're a dude. He has to keep telling himself that, you know, this is a man. And then some people, it's just a character. It's not man or woman. It's just, you know, a person. You know, I just met this entertainer, and you don't try to categorize him.
I'm going to be free. I'm going to express myself. Thank you. I'm going to express myself.
Blossoming like a flower. He's coming out of his cocoon. He's got wings.
I'm getting in touch with my feminine side, and maybe later I might touch my feminine side.
And I might touch it, too.
He might touch it, too.
I got a call from this woman. She was just beside herself. She said, Darcelle, said, I don't know. She said, I just found my husband. I found some underwear and ladies' under things or garments in my husband's car. I knew it was coming. And she said, I confronted him with it because I thought he had some woman. No, they were his, that he snuck around and would change into those and go places or do whatever he did. She said, I'm leaving him. She said, we've only been married a year. And she said, I'm leaving him. And I said, listen to me for a minute before you make any decisions. First of all, the man is a transvestite.
I'm just a sweet transvestite. From transsexual, transylvania.
I'll tell you something, lady. If you go along, if you can find it in your heart to go along with his, with his trans, being a transvestite, you will have a husband that will never cheat on you. He will never do anything but be the kindest, the most gracious, the most wonderful husband you'll ever have. So if you hang on to him this way, my dear, you will be one happy woman. Well, what, about 10 years later? She called. Darcelle, you probably don't remember me. And as soon as she started the story, of course I remember. I said, yes, I remember. How are you? We have three children. I am the happiest. He's the best provider in the world. He's the best. We have matching nightgowns. And we are the happiest couple on our block in the world, she said. Thank you so much, Darcelle. I'm an honorary member of the Northwest Gender Alliance. They are my friends. And I welcome them. We welcome them with open arms when they come to the club. We make sure they feel comfortable because maybe it's their first time ever.
I came alone and I sat right over against that wall. I could probably pick the exact spot. It was so important to me. And immediately, I don't think I was here 3 minutes, and Darcelle herself came up and introduced herself to me, and I was shocked. I didn't know why she would do that or what to say, but she really made me feel welcome. She seemed to look right through me and know that that day was important to me, and I told her it was. And sort of as a mother, she's like, you know, do whatever is right for you, honey, but, you know, be careful or something. And that's really been important. I mean, it's been a process of being freeing and being smart at the same time.
We talk. They want to know where I buy my shoes. I tell them where I buy my shoes. You know, that sort of thing. Where do you get your makeup? You should wear, and I said, well, you need a little more makeup, because usually most of them don't put a lot of makeup on. That sort of thing.
As I've evolved in my own self, a lot of people perceive me as a drag queen, and that's not appropriate, even at work. But that's all people know, because they haven't been educated of the whole spectrum.
They come to us because we are men. They know we're men, and they know that we wear women's clothing, but ours are costumes, theirs are streetwear. But they come to us because they feel that we are of their same feelings or same reasons for wearing women's clothes. The thing is, I'm not a transvestite. I don't do it for sexual reasons. I don't wear women's underwear at all. Even now, I mean, I don't wear a bra. I've never had a bra. I've never owned a bra. Some drag queens wear bras, but I find a place to put my five falsies without that. I was the nicest, cutest little boy in the whole world.
I bet you were.
They called me Sonny. My family called me Sonny, because my name is Walter after my grandfather. So they called me Sonny. But I had really good relationship with my whole family, you know, because, you know, I helped them decorate. How's that? I loved my family. We had a great family, and they were very nice to me.
When you see pictures of the mill houses, they're pretty stark and spare.
Yeah, there was two bedrooms and a living room and a kitchen. That was it. We didn't have a phone forever, and I didn't see television until I got in when I'm in the military and went to New York. We didn't have television.
Can you say more about the kind of work your dad did at the mill?
I know that I tried it for one day on the green chain, and I left. That wasn't too much for me to do, with pulling lumber. I had slivers where nobody should have slivers. And it's hard, hard, hard work. He worked on the water and cork boots, and he'd feed the logs up into the mill to be cut out of the big log rafts. Pretty dangerous, but also pretty hard work pulling those logs around. Now that was mostly his job. But he could have worked anywhere, because he'd worked ever since he was a kid.
So we worked. And he'd been through some strikes, horrible strikes, that they had goons come down and beat him up, and strike breakers try to come in, and so Linton was a real community of turmoil and yet love and tenderness too. It was a whole big hodgepodge. Everybody knew everybody else's business. They all knew what was going on. They all dated everybody else. You never went out. It didn't seem like we ever knew there was anything else but Linton. So if you were going to go on a date, you went on a date with somebody in Linton. And I married a Linton girl.
There were some important strikes in Linton that
made the difference. There were three huge mills working 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And so that was a lot of work and a lot of people, yeah.
Do you remember, with some of those strikes, any sense of what the workers were fighting for?
All they wanted was wages. They didn't have things like health plans, and they just wanted enough money to feed their families. That's all they were asking for. I mean, somebody was making a lot of money on that lumber, but I think they weren't even getting a dollar an hour. I walked by because our house was very close to the entrance to one of the mills, and I would walk by, and there would be the strike signs, and there would be the yelling and stuff, but it didn't really soak in. And my father was a very, very handsome man, and he worked every single day of his life at the mill, rugged outdoors man who was a sweetheart, but he also was an alcoholic and totally impossible for a child to deal with. I never could ever depend on anything from him. A love, attention, nothing. Because he would go from, and it's part, I understand these things now because you don't when you're a kid, but my mother passed away and he adored her. He never remarried. And he was very young when she passed away. And the night she died, he was working, and I ran to get him through berry bushes and things. You have to know Linton to know that it's just wilderness practically, with no shoes on, barefoot, to get him really quick. My aunt sent me to get him real quick. I ran all the way to the mill to get him. I ran all the way back. He ran in front of me, and never said anything to me. You see what I mean? He left me, so did she. And then he became that's when he really started the alcoholic thing, and I couldn't understand why I would be at home alone. He would go leave right after dinner. He would be gone to drink. So I was not only abandoned by my mother dying, but I was abandoned by him. So I felt that I went through, and then pretty soon I just said, I don't care anymore. But I had my aunt. My aunt Lil was kind of, she was kind of the matriarch of the family. She wasn't but she was kind of, they all came to her for things, and she was my mother. She had these nice, massive, massive bosoms. And I think to this day, that's why I have so much fun at the club when I do my thing about women's babalambas and things and have a good time. It's an affectionate thing. It's not a put-down thing, because I can remember when I was a kid whenever I needed help, I was in here. Mm-hmm.
Boom. her bigness represented strength to
yeah.
you.
She was my strength, because I was a little fairy kid, and I didn't know it, a little sissy boy, and I didn't know it. They let me know a few times, but it never bothered me. I didn't know, but she never. We never talked about it either. I never could go home and say, some kid just hit me in the face because he called me a queer. Not queer, because they didn't know queer then. It was, you were a fairy, yeah. And but I couldn't tell her that. But she had to know, because there was always the cuddle. Mm-hmm. And you made me cry.
I went to Mary Frank's Lloyd's and walked the perfume counter, and there she stood. 7 foot tall, 112 pounds. Have you seen the bitch? Skinny people piss me off.
A group of ladies came in, and they sat at the end of the runway, and they were just like just average ladies. I don't know, Southwest or somewhere, just average looking ladies. And they were kind of talking among themselves, and the show started,
And this one lady was sitting there. She was looking really sad. You know, and they, none of them were really carrying on. And I said, "You have the most gorgeous Bahamas I have ever seen in my entire life, lady friend." Well, her face lit up. Her friends looked at me like I had just stepped in cow dew. And then they saw that she was laughing, and they were laughing and weeping. She had had, this is her first time out from a double mastectomy.
We are very, very happy to be here tonight to present you with this plaque.
A plaque?
From Olak.
Olak.
For your community, for your community service.
Oh, thank you.
And for all the work that you've done in the larger community, as well as the gay and lesbian community, as we call it, the queer community today. And Darcelle, I want to say something personally, what you've done for me. You're lending your space to Foxy Lady about 20 years ago, and the Turnabout show that runs today as well raised my self-esteem and the self-esteem of many young people, and gave me a place to perform when I was turned down by others looking for better trained voices. And when I was looking for a birthday card from home and it didn't come, I came here for 20 years and got my birthday greeting here at Darcelle Club. Made us smile, 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 and you continue to do so.
Why lesbians never go on diets or wear makeup. I'm taking my life in my damn hands right now. Okay, this may be my last showbiz night. Why lesbians never go on diets or wear makeup, because it's very difficult to eat Jenny Craig when you have Mary Kay on your face.
She wanted to know if what I thought about her coming out of the closet. Well, I almost fell over, because she obviously is, I mean, to me, she is a lesbian. She had, she had a crew cut and gray hair and men's clothing on. And I assumed that, why would she have to start coming out now at 60, some over 60? But her family doesn't know. It's to her family she was worried about. And I thought, she has children and she's grandmother. And so she was very, very concerned about what I thought, whether she should come out to them or not.
What do you think she was looking to you for?
I don't know what she wanted me to say. My first impression was, well, if they don't know now, why bother? If it's not an issue, why bother with it? And I said that to her. And then she said, but it's bothering me not doing. Then I said, if it's bothering you, come out.
So what do you do for a living in Albany?
I'm a steel worker.
Oh.
That's very much.
Where do you make steel? Isn't steel hard? Steel's hard. Where do you make steel?
In Albany.
Really? They have a steel manufacturing place there?
Well, zirconium, titanium.
Oh, you work for Watching?
Yeah.
Oh, good for you. Yeah, you probably glow in the dark. Shit. Nice to have you here. Happy birthday.
Just keep the show rolling as it is. Now,
Celeste will be
what
down.
What happened?
Darcelle's knee gave out. She can't walk.
This is something you'll never catch on the film. If something happens to Roxy, no matter what, how minor, as simple as diarrhea not being able to be here, something will happen to Darcelle.
Oh my God.
She's so dedicated to it.
But she has to stay. She's going to hurt herself more. I think she should go home. She's done the monologue.
Yeah, right.
But she has to stick to it. I guess that's why she's been here 38 years, right?
Yes.
Let the show go on. I just can't give up those little spots that I worked so hard to make sure they fit. Now, okay.
You rest?
Yeah, I'm gonna stand up, and I'm sure. See, I know it's gonna be okay, because it's even better. No.
Oh.
I'm not like a mattress cover.
Here last time, there was a guy in a cowboy hat sitting in the back, very, very stiff, you know, he's like, you know, and they were kind of, Darcelle in the crowd, you know, he comes out, does his little routine and comedy thing, and he was kind of poking a little fun at the guy, and the guy was like, you know, he didn't really care for it. By the end of the show, that guy was having the funnest time. It was almost like he had transformed a little bit and, you know, done a little bit of opening of his own mind and accepted the way things were and just was cool with it. I mean, he was having fun and he was totally, you know, yelling back and having, you know, a great old time.
I've been walking these streets so long, singing the same old song. I know every crack on these dirty sidewalks of Broadway, where hustle's the name of the game. Nice guys get washed away like the snow in the rain. There's been a load of compromising on the road to my horizon, but I'm gonna be where the lights are shining on me, like a rhinestone cowboy riding out on a horse in a star.
That you can think exactly the same way you did before you entered it. There's just no way. Because if you watch the show, it entraps you. You actually get to associate somewhat with these people. You realize they're normal people that work, hold jobs, and love, and do the same thing that you do. It's just they have a little bit different of a way of expressing their sexuality or something else. And there's just no way you can come in here and then leave and think exactly the same thing that you did before you came in. You know?
Most people are fenced in. Their lives are totally fenced in. Come on. Wouldn't you hope that if people are fenced in, that there's holes in the fence so they can see another world out there? Wouldn't you hope that? I hope that.
Isn't it rich? Are we a pair? Me here at last on the ground, you in midair. Where are the clowns? Isn't it bliss? Don't you approve? Okay. keeps tearing around, one who can't move. Where are the clowns? There ought to be clowns. Just when I stopped opening doors, finally knowing the one that I wanted was yours, making my entrance again with my usual flair, sure of my lines, no one is there. Isn't it rich? Isn't it queer? Losing my time in this late in my career. But where are the clowns? There ought to be clowns. Well, maybe next year.
Consider the date in the landscape. It protects the trees and the honeybees. I'm backing up backwards, making bad words, telling the best in things to stay ahead of me, but I will not fall out, no, no, from the many times of watching.
Now there's a man in a dress.
That's I know. Didn't he have some nice robes? That's him. Yeah.
Someone said the other night that Jesus wore dresses.
Sure, sure.